Hello, my name is Akin Yunal. I'm a PhD student at ETH Zurich. When I started my PhD 2 years ago, my supervisor said to me, hey, we have compact functional encryption schemes for quadratic polynomials from pairings. Also, we have this very nice assumption called learning of errors with very nice mathematical properties. Why don't you try to achieve compact functional encryption schemes for quadratic polynomials from this assumption learning of errors? Naive as I was at that time, I thought, oh yeah, that sounds doable. However, several very frustrating months later, I realized that it's very hard to construct new functional encryption schemes from length space assumptions. So I gave up and I asked myself, okay, there are probably a lot of people who are way more competent than me, work on this subject right now, and still we don't know any new functional encryption schemes from length space assumptions beyond inner product encryption. Are there maybe any inherent reasons why this task is so complicated or maybe impossible? This question led to a paper which I'm going to present here. Learning with errors is a cryptographic hardness assumption which says that an adversary cannot distinguish a rectangular random matrix over set module Q with an undetermined high number of rows from another random matrix of the same shape where the last column is a secret linear combination of alpha columns plus a small Gaussian noise vector. Despite the Gaussian noise added to the last column of a random matrix, it is possible to exploit the homomorphic properties of this assumption and construct very powerful cryptographic primitives. For example, fully homomorphic encryption, lockable obfuscation, attribute-based encryption, and many more. But what about functional encryption? In fact, if we compare schemes from lattice-based assumptions and from bilinear groups, then we see that lattice-based schemes are far behind pairing-based ones. While inner product encryption can be achieved by both types of assumptions, there are no lattice-based function hiding inner product encryption schemes. Further, we can achieve compact functional encryption schemes for quadratic polynomials from pairings, but not from lattice-based assumptions. However, here the list of functional encryption schemes stops. At the current moment, we cannot construct provably secure compact functional encryption for cubic polynomials from any standard assumption. Why are those schemes interesting? Because we know they would imply indistinguishability obfuscation. For the sake of completeness, we should also mention that we can always convert an inner product encryption scheme to a non-compact functional encryption scheme for constant degree polynomials by linearizing the corresponding polynomials. Also, in this list, we omitted all kinds of identity and attribute-based encryption schemes, and also functional encryption schemes with a bounded number of secret keys. In this talk, we will focus on function hiding inner product encryption. The big question is, what hinders us from constructing function hiding inner product encryption schemes whose security can be proven solely from a learning with errors assumption? We will not definitely answer this question here, but we will give some intuition which mathematical obstacles make the task of constructing lattice-based function hiding functional encryption schemes hard. Let us first define inner product encryption schemes. We will look here only at symmetric schemes. A secret key inner product encryption scheme enables the functionality of computing a scalar product modulo p. Messages and functions are both n-dimensional vectors over a set modulo p. On input security parameter lambda, the setup algorithm computes a master secret key. With this master secret key, we can encrypt messages via the encryption algorithm and compute secret keys for function vectors We have a key generation algorithm. Given a ciphertext for message X and a secret key for function vector Y, we decryption algorithm can now decrypt to a scalar product of X and Y modulo P. We call an inner product encryption scheme correct if its decryption algorithm outputs the correct result with an overwhelming probability. We call an inner product encryption scheme selectively function hiding indistinguishable under chosen plaintext attacks secure for M secret keys with the advantage of each PPT adversary A in the following security game is negligible in our security parameter lambda. First, the adversary computes T candidate ciphertexts for world 0 and world 1 and M candidate functions for world 0 and world 1. T is a polynomial which depends on the size of adversary, while M is some arbitrary fixed parameter. The adversary submits all candidate ciphertexts and functions to a challenger. Then, the challenger draws a random bit B, computes the ciphertexts and secret keys of the messages and functions of world B, and sends them back to the adversary. The adversary can now perform arbitrary computations. At the end, he has to guess in which world he lives. He wins a run of this game if he guessed correctly and if the candidate messages and functions don't tell him trivially in which world he lived. His advantage is twice his success probability minus 1. For some parameter m, which may depend on lambda, we say the scheme is selectively m function hiding in CPA secure if advantage for each PPT adversary is negligible. If an inner product encryption scheme is selectively M function hiding in CPA secure for each polynomial M lambda, then it is secure for an unbounded number of secret keys, and we just omit the M from a security notion. Now, imagine we would know that there are no lattice-based function-hiding inner product encryption schemes, and we would want to prove this fact. Since we know that there are pairing-based function-hiding IPE schemes, we cannot show unconditionally that there are no function-hiding inner product encryption schemes. Instead, the term lattice-based has to exclude such pairing-based schemes. Therefore, our idea is to replace the term lattice-based by concrete mathematical requirements at encryption and decryption, which are motivated by popular design patterns in lattice-based crypto schemes. In most lattice-based functional encryption schemes, but also in lattice-based identity and attribute-based schemes, ciphertexts and secret keys are vectors over set modulo Q for some exterior modulus Q, and the message space is some vector space over set modulo P. Also in most cases, to decrypt a ciphertext with a secret key, we have to compute the inner product of both modulo Q, divide this by a Q to P ratio, and round this to the nearest element in set modulo P. We will call this procedure linear decryption. In almost all lattice-based, functional, identity-based, and attribute-based encryption schemes, the encryption procedure can be split into two parts, an offline and an online part. The offline part is very complex, but independent of an input message, and serves to sample some complex randomness. The online part is very simple, and applies the output of the offline part to an input message in an algebraically simple way. We will model this property as follows. The offline part is encapsulated in an algorithm encoff, which, on input the master secret key, samples s multinomial integer polynomials of total degree d for some constant d. The online part then evaluates these polynomials at the input message x. It reduces their values modulo q and outputs them as a ciphertext for x. We call such encryption procedure online offline of DEF-D. We can now state the main result of our work. We prove that an inner product encryption scheme with linear decryption and offline-online encryption of constant depth cannot be selectively function hiding in CPA secure for an unbounded number of secret keys. In our paper, we can even give an upper bound M for a maximum number of secret keys which can be handed out to adversary before he can launch an attack. However, this result does not hold unconditionally. We need that the exterior and interior moduli fulfill some requirements. But since these requirements are not atypical for let space schemes, we do not think that they limit the intuition which is provided by our results. Before we can talk about the proof of this result, we need some more notions and terms for offline-online encryption. We said that a functional encryption scheme is of DEF-D if its encryption algorithm splits into an offline and an online part. The offline part samples a number of multivariate integer polynomials of total degree D, and the online part evaluates them at input message X and reduces their values modulo Q. Since the online part reduces their values modulo Q, we call this an encryption procedure of DEF-D over set modulo Q. If no arithmetical reduction does happen in the online part, however, then we call this an encryption procedure of DEF-D over the integers. Further, if you have an encryption algorithm of DEF-D over set, then its generated ciphertexts are just vectors over the integers. We say the encryption algorithm is of width B if, with all valid probability, the infinity norm of a ciphertext is bounded by B. That is, if the absolute value of each entry of a ciphertext is smaller than B. If our ciphertexts are vectors over set modulo Q, then we say the encryption algorithm is of width B if the absolute value of each entry of a ciphertext is bounded by B, where we identify set modulo Q with the integers centered around 0. Okay, so how do we prove our main result here? We have to show that for each inner product encryption scheme, there is a PPT adversary who wins a selective function hiding in CPA security game with non-negligible advantage by querying secret keys for m plus 1 function vectors. Instead of directly constructing an adversary, we prove this result in 3 steps. First, we show that each m plus 1 function hiding in CPA secure inner product encryption scheme of constant depth can be transformed by an adversary to a secure secret key encryption scheme of width Q over P and of constant depth. Note that this secret key encryption scheme is of polynomial width, since we require that Q over P is bounded by a polynomial. In a second step, we show that an adversary can then transform this in-CPA secure secret key encryption scheme over set modulo Q to a secret key encryption scheme over the integers with constant depth and polynomial width. Finally, we construct a general adversary who can break the in-CPA security of each secret key encryption scheme of constant depth and polynomial width over the integers by performing statistical tests. Altogether, this proves that there can be no function hiding in CPA secure inner product encryption scheme with linear decryption and offline-online encryption. We want to very roughly sketch each of the steps and give vague ideas which properties we exploit in which step. In the first step, the adversary has to transform a function hiding IP scheme of constant depth linear decryption, to a secret key encryption scheme of constant depth and with Q over P. First note that each inner product encryption scheme is already a secret key encryption scheme. Also note that both schemes are of constant depth over set module Q. So you only need to do one thing. We need to trade off the function hiding property and the linear decryption of our IP scheme against short ciphertexts in our SKE scheme. So how can our adversary do this? He queries m different secret keys for a zero function vector. When we decrypt such a secret key with a ciphertext, then the result must be zero because of correctness. Therefore, we know that the inner product of each of those secret keys with a ciphertext must be small. These inner products are the decryption noises which are cut off when we round to the nearest element and set modulo p. Since our IPE scheme is function hiding, our secret key for function vector y must look similar to m secret keys our adversary has drawn. In fact, one can show that with non-negligible probability, a secret key for an arbitrary vector y must lie in a linear space spanned by the m secret keys for a zero function. This implies that in a non-negligible number of cases, the inner product of the secret key for function vector y with a ciphertext can be reconstructed from the decryption noises of the m secret keys for a zero function when applied to that ciphertext. Therefore, our idea here is to use the specter of m decryption noises as new ciphertexts in our secret key encryption scheme. When decryption noises are small, they can be computed by an encryption algorithm of constant depth, and they contain a non-negligible amount of information about the encrypted message X. In the second step, our adversary has to transform a secret key encryption scheme of constant depth over set module Q and with Q over P to a secret key encryption scheme of constant depth and polynomial width over integers. Note that both SKE schemes are of constant depth and of polynomial width. The only thing that differs is the ring about which the computations at encryption to happen. We need to go from set module Q to set. So we have to get rid of arithmetic reductions in the online part of the encryption algorithm. We will only extremely roughly sketch the idea of how to do this here. The main observation is that, since our starting scheme is of bounded width, the output values of each polynomial sampled by the offline part of our starting scheme must be small when evaluated in the inputs from a message space. From this observation, we can deduce that all polynomials sampled by the offline part must have small coefficients. Now, when we evaluate a polynomial with small coefficients at a small enough input, then the output value will be bounded by q halves. In this case, there is no need to apply an arithmetic reduction module Q, since this would not change the output value. This gives a very rough idea how we can convert our starting scheme to a secret key encryption scheme over the integers without any arithmetic reduction. Finally, we have to give a general adversary who can win the selective in CPA security game of each secret key encryption scheme over the integers of constant depth and polynomial width. Remember that in this game the challenger draws a random bit B, which the adversary has to guess, and that the adversary submits two sets of messages for world 0 and world 1, but he only receives the ciphertexts of messages for World B. Now, for some non-zero message X, our adversary queries a lot of ciphertext for messages 0, B times X, and X. He receives the ciphertext for messages 0, B times X, and X without knowing B. He can now approximate the means of the squares of the entries of these ciphertexts very closely. After doing this, he looks if one of the means of the squared entries of a ciphertext of 0 times B is closer to a means of 0 or closer to a means of X. And then, depending on this, guesses if B was 0 or 1. The proof that the advantage of this adversary is non-negligible now just consists of a rigorous sequence of mathematical lemmas and calculations. This concludes the proof for our impossibility theorem. We have shown that lattice-based functional encryption schemes, which use popular design choices like encryption and decryption, cannot be function hiding in CPA secure. However, does this mean that lattice-based function hiding function encryption schemes cannot be secure in general? Well, we don't know. We could determine some mathematical pitfalls which will inevitably lead to insecurities. We could also show that one needs to deviate from standard constructions to avoid these pitfalls. For example, gadget matrices could be a solution here, or nested modular operations, or encryption algorithms of polynomial depth. Ring learning of errors on its own, however, will not be a solution to circumvent our impossibility theorem. All in all, the subject of functional encryption stays exciting and supposedly very hard. Thank you for watching.